This is dated April 24, 1945, from the Secretary of War, Henry Stimson, saying, "Mr. President, I think it's very important that I should have a talk with you as soon as possible on a highly secret matter. I mentioned it to you shortly after you took office, but have not urged it since on account of the pressure you've been under. It, however, has such a bearing on our present foreign relations and has such an important effect upon all my thinking in this field that I think you ought to know about it without much further delay." This is Stimson asking for a meeting with Truman to tell him about the atomic bomb on April 24th, 1945, right around the time Germany surrendered. And I think he got a meeting the next day, put on list tomorrow, Wednesday 25th. So he got a, and that's Truman's initials there. So Stimson immediately got an appointment and told him about the atomic bomb. So to me, it's an interesting question of how, I mean, having known at the end of April that there was this weapon, this secret weapon, and then his own thought processes of how to use, what to do with it, as he negotiated with Stalin from a pretty weak position. I mean, Truman, it's not the United States was weak, but Truman was not a strong person in foreign relations, not like Roosevelt had been. As research continued into 1944, the scientists realized that the little boy bomb, the gun assembly bomb, was probably going to work. But they weren't so sure about the implosion bomb, the Fat Man bomb. So they started looking around places to test the Fat Man bomb. The bomb, a Trinity, was on a 100-foot tower. And the blast depressed the desert around there. It also fused the sand into trinitite, a type of glass. But it also depressed. So when you go there, the place where the tower was is probably about 10 or 15 feet depressed down from where it would have been without the bomb. So they realized that, you know, this was a lot of the destructive power right there under the bomb. If you detonate a bomb 1,000 or 2,000 feet up, that blast wave will spread out a lot farther and will cause a lot more destruction. So that's why, so from the test, they realized they needed to detonate the bomb higher up in the atmosphere. On July 16th, 1945, the test succeeded at about 5:35 in the morning. They wanted it when it was still dark so that it could they could record it with this. They made incredibly rapid cameras in Los Alamos just to record this test that went that took photos at 10,000 frames a second. The test worked. People were relieved. People were frightened. Stanislaw Ulam, who was one of the co-creators of the H-bomb, was in Los Alamos. He didn't go down for the test. And he saw that afternoon people coming back from the Los Alamos and getting off on the buses, and he knew something had rattled them, that they had seen something that people had never seen before. And Oppenheimer himself said, and he quoted some Hindu scripture, he quoted scripture from Bhagavad Gita that said, "I am death, destroyer of worlds."
We knew the world would not be the same. A few people laughed. A few people cried. Most people were silent. I remembered the line from the Hindu scripture, the Bhagavad Gita. Vishnu is trying to persuade the prince that he should do his duty, and to impress him takes on his multi-armed form and says, "Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds." I suppose we all thought that one way or another.
Now this is a guy who knew exactly what happened out in the desert on July 16, 1945. I mean, he had directed all of the physics and engineering that went into building this bomb, but he had to go to this religion that has these gods poised over the earth, ready to destroy everything and all the humans and living beings on earth at a second's moment to really come to grasp in a more fundamental way of what was unleashed in that desert. And this is a press release sent by the president from the president's office stating 16 hours ago an American airplane dropped one bomb on blank. It's obviously made beforehand. And it destroyed its usefulness to the enemy. That bomb had more power than 20,000 tons of TNT. It had more than 2,000 times the blast power of the British Grand Slam, which is the largest bomb ever used in history of warfare. Japanese officials in Tokyo didn't know what happened, because all of a sudden, all communication with Hiroshima was cut off. So they had to send somebody from Tokyo there. It took a day for the person, or for the group of people, to get to Hiroshima to figure out what happened. They looked around for a day, and then they went back to Tokyo to report what they saw. And by that time, the bomb was dropped in Nagasaki on August 9th, 1945. Effects of the atomic blast, in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, 50% of the people were casualties because of the blast energy. Just that blast that knocked buildings down, that made a panel of glass like this into shrapnel, and just would then, you know, impale people who were in the room. A building would be blown apart by the blast, and nails would penetrate and kill people. Just from the buildings that became huge shrapnel generators. 35% were harmed by the thermal energy that kimono shot. I mean, that thermal energy that then started the fires that just swept through Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And then 15% were harmed by nuclear radiation. That figure probably would have been a lot higher if the other two effects hadn't have been there. Atomic bombing of Japan didn't win the war. What won the war were the men and women who fought in the United States and with our allies, Great Britain, even Russia. They prosecuted the war, so it was close to ending. The men and women who built the incredible war machine during World War II, the planes, the bombers, the tanks, the trucks, the Liberty ships, I think they won the war as well as the soldiers. But this ended the war. The atomic bombing on August 6th and August 9th ended the war.